It was the hardest of places to get into and hardest to guess he'd be hiding in. This is all that's left of where the world's most wanted man hid, possibly for weeks. Much of intelligence value whisked away, flattened to rubble by repeated airstrikes. Cleared up, it seems, by the Islamists who control the area. We obtain these images from a local cameraman, able to function in a region where Al-Qaeda are strong, but where, elsewhere, civilians are bombed too often for life to be normal. Two of the dead here collected and taken away. Shells litter the area, perhaps from the 8 helicopters that arrived here in the dead of night before US commandos blew holes through the compound walls. Ahmed was woken just before 11 p.m. local time and was shocked to see helicopters hovering about 150 meters up. 90 minutes later, a blast follows. Doors and windows of houses as far as 1 kilometer away were completely shattered, he said. We waited until sunrise before we came here and we saw the bodies of the martyrs, women and children, body parts, about 6 to 7 dead. In the morning, we heard that Baghdadi was here, but people living here thought displaced people from Aleppo lived in the house, working in the cattle and grain trade. No one knows, he said, exactly what happened. Somewhere below this dust is the tunnel where President Donald Trump said Baghdadi blew himself up, killing his 3 children with him. But by dawn, there was so little left to pick over here. Baghdadi's sudden end, as fleeting as his appearances in the world he cursed with radicalized violence. Nick Paton Walsh, CNN, Erbil, Northern Iraq.
The leader of ISIS may be dead, but analysts say the group's violent ideology and influence is still a big concern. Under Baghdadi's reign, ISIS terrorists took the innocent lives of countless people, and among them many Americans. Sadly, their names get lost as time passes. James Foley, a journalist, Kayla Mueller, a humanitarian aid worker, and this young man, Peter Kasich, who CNN interviewed in 2012.
We each get one life, and that's it. You get one shot at this. We don't get any do-overs, you know? And like for me, it was time to put up or shut up. The way I saw it, I didn't have a choice. You know, like, this is what I was put here to do. I guess I'm just a hopeless romantic, and I'm an idealist, and I believe in hopeless causes. There's this impression, this belief that there is no hope, you know. That's when it's more important than ever that we come in against all odds and try to do something.
Salome Anderson is sitting here with me now, and for you, I see the tears in your eyes. Those are so genuine. This is so personal. You were really close. That was your friend, Peter Kasich, yeah, who was killed by ISIS terrorists. What was your reaction when you heard the ISIS leader had been killed?
It's pretty complicated. I mean, obviously, the impulse is to say, thank God that this man is gone from the world, but on several other levels, I reacted in a way that many people might find a little strange, but from a strategic counterterrorism perspective, as well as from an emotional perspective, I just think there's a lot more going on than people are really talking about. For example, I've heard many people speak about the ideology and how difficult it is to combat, but I'm not sure how many people have really been talking about the lessons of history. And I'm not talking about like ancient history, I'm talking about very recent history. If you look at what happened with Zarqawi, the leader of AQI, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, which was basically the core of what became ISIS, so many mistakes were being made at that time that are being repeated now. You had an administration that was dedicated to the idea of declaring victory, ignoring the arising insurgency, ignoring intelligence that was telling them that this was still a threat. The sectarian tensions that were being ignored or exacerbated, no de-radicalization efforts. There were so many things that were going on that are happening again, and I see it happening, and it just makes me think, you know, we're going to live through it again.
So I hear the concern in your voice and in your words about, you know, what is next and how this is just maybe one moment to celebrate, but it doesn't resolve the conflict and the problem and the root cause of the death of your friend Peter Kasich. Because you were close with him, have you had a chance to talk to his family?
I have, yeah.
Today?
Yeah.
And what is their thought about all of this?
I don't want to speak for them, but I would say overall they agree with me, and the impression that I got is that they would prefer that this be addressed in a more effective way, creating dialogue, reconciliation, lasting change, as opposed to, I don't want to put words in their mouths, but symbolic killings.
We talk so much about Baghdadi today and about these terrorists, and I really want to take a moment to honor the lives that have been taken way too soon. Tell us more about your friend Peter.
You just from watching that short clip, I think you could probably get a sense of him. He was exactly as he presented himself in that, just pure heart, all just very transparent. There was no calculation. There was no sort of machinations going on there. What you saw was what you got with Pete. I've never met anyone like him. He just wanted to help. That's all he wanted.
And he was in Syria to help those people who were suffering in the civil war. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, he went in there to save civilian lives, risking his own, and for no reason. He had nothing connecting him to the region other than his time as a ranger during the Iraq War. He felt a responsibility to try and rebuild what he saw as what we had destroyed in the region, and he wanted to do it with his skills, which were medical.
What needs to happen now in terms of honoring Peter, honoring other victims? I know you have interviewed, as a journalist yourself, other people who've been victimized by ISIS, women who've been raped, children who have been orphaned. You've talked with ISIS members as well. What do you think the solution is in terms of combating this terror group?
Well, I mean, I think, first of all, the way to honor their victims is to prevent more of them. And there are many, many steps we could be taking that we're not. For example, we could be stabilizing the region. I know people think nation building is like a bad term, but in a way, I mean, it's very necessary to build up institutions, to build up moderate forces in the region, moderate military forces and government forces, like maybe the Kurds, which isn't going so well right now. Assisting in processing prisoners and securing them. And then something that is really dear to my heart that people don't really talk about is the de-radicalization process, because you have these children who I've interviewed who were raised in ISIS schools. They've been brainwashed, basically, at a young age. And you take them and you throw them in a displacement camp in terrible, inhumane conditions, and you leave them just to radicalize further. And there's no effort made on a therapeutic level, on any sort of level, to de-radicalize them and sort of divert them from that path. I just feel like we're making the same mess that we made before. And I don't want to minimize the loss that this is to ISIS. It's a huge symbolic loss, obviously, but not 90%, they've already groomed another leader, and the networks are all still in place, and they're going into insurgency mode as they did previously. Like, one man's death is not the death of an ideology.